each individual, woman or girl, that causes physical or psychological harm, humiliation or arbitrary deprivation of liberty that perpetuates female subordination. Rape is recorded as one of the worst forms of gender-based violence with long-term implications. Women face violence daily in diverse places that include home, workplace, the campus, office, health facilities, to mention but a few. Gender-based violence is a growing public health concern, with 30% women having experienced a form of physical or sexual abuse by an intimate partner. In Zimbabwe, 35% of women reported ever experiencing physical or sexual violence. The World Health Organization recommends standard care for sexual abuse that includes consent, documentation, medical examination, investigations, treatment, and referral. Regionally, the SADC Protocol on Gender and Development prescribed comprehensive testing, treatment and care of survivors of sexual abuse that includes emergency contraception, ready access to post-exposure prophylaxis at all health facilities to reduce risk of contracting HIV and preventing the onset of sexually transmitted infections. The timely provision of health care to victims of sexual abuse is crucial, as several aspects of the care are time dependent. In view of this, let us not forget that delivery of clinical care by competent and compassionate healthcare providers is essential to prevent adverse consequences and begin a survivor's physical and emotional healing. In Kanoma, victims of sexual abuse are attended in the outpatient department. The doctor has an obligation to manage the victim, complete the medical affidavit. The custodian of the medical affidavit for sexual abuse is the Minister of Health and Child Care, and the primary purpose of the medical affidavits being for monitoring management of sexual abuse, as well as provide legal evidence for the jury. Despite having complaints of delays in management of sexual abuse victims, incomplete medical affidavits, unfriendly environment, the medical affidavits had never been analyzed to assess the appropriateness of care given to sexual abuse victims. Hence, we analyzed the affidavits with an objective to determine the proportion of victims who received HIV post-exposure prophylaxis, emergency contraception, follow-up care, and forensic tests. We carried out a retrospective, descriptive cross-sectional study based on secondary data analysis. The study population being all medical affidavits completed between 2014 and 2016, with a single victim's affidavit as the study unit. A total of 357 medical affidavits were randomly selected. Names of victims, healthcare providers, and police officers were kept confidential. Data was extracted from hard copies using a checklist that captured the variables listed, among others. Data entry and analysis was done using EPI Info 7, and these are our results. The median age of victims was 14 years, with 78% of victims being less than 16 years, while least that of the perpetrators was 21 years. 85% of the sexual assaults were done by someone known to the victim. Those said to be boyfriends accounted for 46% of the sexual assaults. Male perpetrators constituted 98% of the assaults. Of the victims abused, 70% had no previous sexual exposure. However, single women were more affected than married women. This bar graph shows the proportions of gathered clinical evidence of penetration. The first four categories representing available evidence of penetration found in the victims, which adds up to 82%. Condom use by the perpetrator, as illustrated by the pie chart, occurred in 9% of the victims. As clinicians, we give medication to prevent HIV and unwanted pregnancies in the first 72 hours after sexual abuse. After this period, medication has been shown to be of no benefit. In our settings, only 25% of victims presented within 72 hours to have medication administered. Despite overwhelming evidence of sexual penetration and no condom use by the perpetrator, only 27 and 56% of victims presenting within 72 hours were given emergency contraception and HIV post-exposure prophylaxis, respectively. An HIV baseline and follow-up test is expected to be done in all victims. Nonetheless, baseline HIV testing was done in 27% of the victims, while at least only 2% had to repeat HIV tests after 3 months. The SADC protocol on gender and development emphasizes the essence of trial for perpetrators by a court of competent jurisdiction. However, fellow healthcare providers, how do we expect to fulfill our promises, yet we provide forensic evidence for the jury in only 8% of the victims of sexual abuse? Of the follow-up tests done, these included HIV tests, pregnancy, syphilis, and urine tests. Nevertheless, no proper counseling and psychological support was offered to all victims seen at this institution. This bar graph illustrates the difference in proportion of victims being tested at first contact and follow-up visits, a decline from 27 to 2% of victims, and this shows the loss to follow-up for victims after the initial visit. The median age of victims was 14 years, and with 88% of the victims falling prey to someone whom they knew before. This finding is consistent with that seen in Nigeria by Akinlusi et al. In 2014, and this illustrates a point of entry in awareness campaigns targeted at this age group. Findings of low post-exposure prophylaxis and emergency contraception coverage are in keeping with a study by Sanjeo et al. 2013. These findings show the need for prioritization of emergency care for gender-based violence victims within our health systems. Lack of training for healthcare workers and clear management protocols remain to hinder delivery of clinical care to sexual abuse victims. Guided accordingly by the World Health Organization guidelines and the SADC protocol on gender and development, we conclude that the clinical care to sexual abuse victims was not appropriate, as evidenced by lack of laboratory forensic tests, provision of HIV prophylaxis, emergency contraception, counseling, and follow-up. Following lessons from this study, we recommend awareness campaigns for victims to seek medical care within 72 hours of sexual assault, introduction of stand-alone clinics, training of healthcare providers, having clear management protocols, and integration of gender-based violence data into existing electronic patient monitoring systems to enable real-time monitoring and evaluation at national level. I would like to acknowledge the following in making our study a success. I thank you.